Good afternoon. I'm Karen Merrill, LCSW and consultant for RBH, and I'm pleased to be presenting today's Lunch and Learn topic, Managing Yourself While Managing Your Workload. So our agenda today, in today's world, workloads can feel overwhelming, particularly when they're compounded by stressors that might be occurring at home and in our personal lives. So today we'll be looking at the signals of distress, some signs of stress overload. We'll talk about hurry sickness, and then we'll give some solutions in terms of time management tips using positive self-talk. And we'll talk about overcoming compassion fatigue as well. We'll be inserting polling questions throughout the presentation. And in all likelihood, there'll be time for questions and answers at the end. So, signals of distress. What are our signs? How do we know? One of them can be time urgency. Getting kind of locked in that battle with the clock, trying to do more and more in less and less time, but falling behind, feeling angry when others seem too slow for our own pace, feeling tense, noticing our muscles tensing, or our posture slumping, or sensing the need to stretch, move, change body positions, which are all good things, actually, in terms of relieving tension. We can feel tired, feeling increasing fatigue in our mind, our body, or our emotions. We can notice a drop in our performance, making mistakes, such as careless errors. We can even feel kind of some diminished coordination in our speech or writing, which can occur when we're flooded by feelings of distress. We can feel more irritable, a rise in frustration, being more pessimistic, impatient, or wanting to distance ourselves from others. We can notice feeling blue or an emotional downturn, even to the extreme, feeling empty, despairing, or more vulnerable. And hostility, a sense or a feeling, a surge of anger at others, and even on some level wanting to teach them a lesson. So these are all our emotional and sometimes body signs of signals of our distress. So in our next slide, we're going to jump right into our first polling question. So, and this is going to be kind of what your sense may be. Which of the following symptoms do you believe would have an overlap between signals of distress or signs of stress overload? Might it be tension, depression, irritability, insomnia, respiratory issues? Which do you think might most clearly there be an overlap between the two? So what we'll do is we'll give you a couple minutes to decide how you might want to vote, and then Brenda will tally it up and we'll see what the group thinks. Okay.
I just closed our first poll, and we have 77% of participants voting for A, tension. 69% voted for B, depression. 83% voted for C, irritability. 75% voted for D, insomnia. And we have 41% voting for E, respiratory issues.
Okay, well, you're right on because even though there can be overlap in all of these areas, the number one occurrence of overlap is irritability, which is where you all did score the highest. So your sense about that is right, that we can feel irritable both as a signal of distress and as a sign of stress overload. So thanks for that. It also helps us understand kind of where you're coming from. So we'll move on to signs of stress overload. So sometimes stress can build actually to some pretty significant levels before we realize what's happening. So if you frequently find you experience any of the following symptoms we're going to look at, you may be reacting poorly to stress, and we can learn more effective coping mechanisms to help us avoid the serious health dangers that can occur from living and with stress over a long period of time. So some clues to watch for. Include that number one, irritability. If you find even that relationships are suffering because of getting feedback that you're critical, or that you find yourself annoyed by petty things and are susceptible to feeling anger, you can feel psychologically upset. You can feel sorry for yourself. That small disappointments can seem overwhelming, or you might feel bored or unmotivated. Those are what we call psychological upsets. Insomnia, very common with stress overload. Trouble, we can fall asleep fairly quickly, but can have trouble staying asleep because we're too tired, too worried, or too keyed up. It's very common. A feeling of fatigue where we just have this kind of weary or wrung out feeling for no apparent reason, and even feeling some aches and pains, headaches and neck and shoulders when it's a result of nothing we can really put our finger on. Signs of stress overload very commonly affect our weight, where we try to cope through, what we call stress eating, or we can lose our appetite or feel as if we don't have the time to take to eat, and so can see some fluctuations in weight, which is, not the best for our health. We can feel fluttering in our heart, or that, it sounds as if our heartbeat is rapid or loud to us. Stomach problems are really common with stress, where you just feel it feel can feel sour or irritated, can have a stomach ache, feel nauseated. Respiratory problems, classic anxiety attacks or signs of stress, people will feel as if they're having a heart attack, really comes from hyperventilating or, breathing from not in the belly, but up in our upper chest. So that's a sign of stress overload, not from physical exhaustion, but really from just stress. So next. So how do we get out of balance? We talk about stress and signals of distress. It's pretty easy to get out of balance with the busy lives that we lead. Can be right off the bat that our expectations aren't realistic, that with all the things we're trying to balance, that we set ourselves up by having lofty expectations of what we think we're able to accomplish. Sometimes it's the demands are too excessive. And those demands that I mention are coming from ourselves and the demands we place on ourselves. and also the environment, either our family or our work. So we get out of balance by feeling pulled in so many directions. Sometimes we don't make a plan. We are so kind of overwhelmed that we're not setting priorities and we're not following a plan. And so we're out of balance by not having a map to kind of look to. Communication can get out of balance where there really isn't enough of it, or our stress is altering our communication so it's not effective enough. Over time, with ongoing stress and distress, we can get stuck where we're not really seeing change as an option. So we keep trying to use ineffective solutions to the same problems that are not really not working for us. You know, we know how important support systems are, and we can get so kind of focused and driven that we're going it alone and not relying on a support system or feeling like we can cultivate it. So that can get us out of balance. And sometimes there's just way too much going on that we're not heeding the warning signs that we talked about of stress overload or signals. So these are ways of getting out of balance in our daily lives. So next. You know, this is really a good one to talk about, you know, this kind of feeling that the hurrier I go, the behinder I get. We don't talk enough about hurry sickness. And in today's world with so many competing demands, it's a malady that many of us suffer from. You ever have the feeling that you're just kind of overwhelmed and it can feel hopeless? We got into work earlier, determined to get caught up, only to get hit with a deluge of crises, interruptions, new projects. We can feel by the end of that day, as we're exhausted, we've worked as hard as humanly possible. Nothing's off the list. And in fact, we've added some things. So consequently, we can feel overwhelmed, hopeless, and discouraged. And it really is that, man, I just can't catch up. It's what we call hurry sickness. So how do we know if we're suffering from hurry sickness? That's the next slide. So people who generally suffer from hurry sickness drive too fast because they're just in a hurry to get where they're going. They interrupt others or finish sentences for others, just being really impatient and finding themselves being in meetings and wishing they could tap their foot because they're impatient with somebody who goes off on a tangent. Finding it difficult to not criticize others who are chronically late. And one of my favorites is rushing to be first in line, even when it doesn't matter. For example, I was just traveling last week and you see people rushing to get off an airplane or in order to be first in line at baggage claim where they're waiting forever. Or my favorite is the one where you go to the grocery store and constantly change lanes and look for the shortest one, and it never seems to be the one that goes the most quickly. People feeling as if that if they have to wait a little too long for service in a store or a restaurant, they get so impatient that they're tempted to leave out of frustration. So any of these reactions that seem to strike a chord, this can be symptoms of hurry sickness. And I know that from time to time, they certainly strike at me. So it's a signal to take a deep breath and slow down, but common enough around us. What else? So even our next slide will go so far as that we view others as less capable, who are slow to act or decide. And in fact, they just might be really relaxed individuals, or thinking that kind of hanging out is a waste of time. Now, certainly, you know, there are limits to how much hanging around the coffee pot you do, but some of that can be kind of team building. Priding yourself on getting things done on time, and even sacrificing the chance to improve on a project or something if it means being late. Ever get any feedback that your partner or your kids are saying that, you know, they're feeling rushed? Another clear symptom of hurry sickness, and feeling like that those who you admire are those who work at the same speedy pace that you might be, because you think that's an indication of efficiency and overall good value. So symptoms of hurry sickness abound around us. So next. Okay, so we're going to head into our second polling question. So all of the following will help slow down hurry sickness, except number one, unlearning old patterns, two, ratcheting down performance speeds, three, making sure to finish that to-do list by the end of the day, or not watching the time on the weekends. Which one do you think comes closest to slowing down hurry sickness? Okay, what do we got, Brenda?
Looks like we have 28% voting for A, unlearn old patterns.
Uh-huh.
16% voted for B, racket down performance speeds. 57% voted for C, make sure to finish that to-do list by the end of the day. And 19% voted for D, don't watch the clock on the weekends.
Okay, well, you guys are good. Again, the one that most clearly will help slow down hurry sickness is to give yourself permission to not finish that to-do list by the end of the day. Because if it's one of those days where you go in and 50, 60% of the energy goes in putting out fires and crises, you might be there until half the night if you had to or said to yourself that you had to finish the to-do list. So knowing when it's okay that's just not a reasonable expectation is a way of slowing down the hurry sickness. And sometimes we're fighting, you know, kind of a cultural organizational norm by slowing ourselves down, but nobody knows how to take care of yourself the best like you do. And so we have to listen to ourselves in these situations. All right. Thanks, Brenda.
You're welcome, Karen.
So back to the presentation. So if we have the courage to recognize our own hurry sickness, then we might want to get more in touch with balancing that compulsive lifestyle with a more nurturing and balanced blend of speeds, choosing, you know, the first gear, second gear, maybe reverse, maybe, you know, not only neutral, but reverse, where we actually slow things down so that we find that we improve our health. Long term, we're going to get more effectiveness and quality of life. And really, in fact, it makes us a better role model, positive role model to those around us, family, kids, and a better leader in the work environment. So, and I think that it's not a bad thing to think of, you know, what are we wanting to model for our family, our kids, and those around us in terms of how we want to be as human beings. All right, next. So it's important that we really must do a lot of unlearning if we're serious about this hurry sickness downshift. We're going to look at trying to break old habits and old patterns of looking at things. And as a rule of thumb, takes 2 to 3 weeks to break habits and kind of let the seeds grow into new patterns of behavior. But some ways of beginning is to actually plan windows of time to go off the clock. And maybe what you do is you actually take a real lunch hour, or, you know, take real break times. We actually find that when we do that, we come back with more oxygen and focus by having had a change of environment than if we try to grind our way through it. Taking off our watch, not, and maybe you're not wearing a watch, but not looking at that iPhone to see what the time is like on the weekend or evening. Even just planning a time to do absolutely nothing, which is going to take some getting used to, and enjoying the feeling of what's it like to daydream or do some doodling or envisioning the places that we feel the most relaxed as a way of slowing down that hurry sickness. Planning each day and looking ahead to the week by including those things. All right, next. So it changes, it really involves changing our reward system. And instead of rewarding ourselves for, you know, finishing everything and being the most efficient person, but actually rewarding ourselves for doing less and becoming acquainted with actually being a human being and not a human doing. You know, for the most part, we've become human doings instead of human beings. So catching ourselves just being and purposefully planning some silence in our life and listening to our intuition in that way can be extremely helpful in changing the way we look at things. You know, I have a niece who excelled all her life in school and in college. And while she was in school, I kept rooting for her to get a B instead of an A because she evaluated herself so much on her accomplishments and still, you know, hope she learns the lessons of being able to be comfortable with making mistakes, and that life is full of that. So kind of slowing that down and changing our reward systems, fighting the culture around us to be able to do that. And it's not easy because we certainly live in a culture where the rule of thumb is to go faster and be more productive. So as we try to really ratchet ourselves down, the next slide will tell us to look at what are then the Ten Commandments of time management. If we've slowed ourselves down, how are we going to get things done? We still need to do our job and succeed in that way. So making a plan. establish a direction of your project that you're trying to accomplish and develop a schedule and milestones around it, assessing the resources required. There was a one of these people that was doing time planning that several years ago that had written a book on the effective habits of the best habits for effective people. He always included some downtime and trying to anticipate the unexpected so that it doesn't crash the whole plan when that happens. Delegating, trying to free yourself up by allowing others to help you. And in a way, you know, it offers growth opportunities to others and setting clear directions. As we kind of indicated, anticipate the unexpected, overestimate the time and space for related tasks, schedule some flex time and allow for some extra problems or difficulties. Keep a master calendar, write commitments in one calendar, review and update it, keep it flexible and uncluttered. Look at the big picture. Don't waste energy by getting too bogged down, but stay focused by establishing goals and reevaluating them to stay on track and allowing yourself to do that. Set a deadline so you have some time frames in mind. And to avoid procrastination, set those deadlines as realistic for each goal. Break up big goals into small projects, mini projects, plan them by time. Staying organized, you know, clutter wastes time. It also clutters up our brain, and then we're not thinking quite as clearly or effectively. So keeping things in proper place to avoid needless searching can be a big time saver. And this is an important one, is being willing to slow down. Take on as much as you're willing and able to do, and know that the world is not going to come to an end if you say no when you need to. You know, the sun will come up the next day and everybody will survive if you're not meeting everybody's needs that quickly or that immediately. So next, this time management matrix can be a very useful tool. And we use this in different ways where you kind of divide things up into quadrants that looks at the things that are being asked of us that are important and urgent, important, not urgent, and then quadrant 3 and 4. So certainly, number one is what grabs our attention, that those things that we come into work and that we're dealing with crises and pressing problems and deadlines are both urgent and important. Sometimes things are not important and urgent. Those are those interruptions, emails, calls and meetings, pressing matters. So looking at how much time is going into quadrant 3 and what might be able to be kind of time managed in that way. Quadrant 2, not urgent, but important. So, and this is what, you know, people that get the hurry sickness, I think, have a harder time with allowing time for. But relationship building is in the not urgent but important category. New opportunities, long-term planning, looking ahead to preventive activities and personal growth and your own self-care and reaction and recreation. Not urgent but absolutely important and probably some of the first things to go when we're feeling pressed. And then quadrant four, which is not important and not urgent. You know, this is, I call this the kind of, you know, when the gossiping occurs, some trivia, busy work, calls and emails, pleasant activities we need time for. But thinking about this matrix and how much time and energy might go into three and four and how that might get redirected. So it's it can be an important tool. So keep that in mind as we move forward. So we're gonna, in the following slide to this, gonna look at another tool, what we call our circle of life, which is an exercise that actually kind of breaks down our investment in time and looks at how we assess our life balance in different categories, knowing that finding balance in our life is the key to reducing stress. And as a prelude, we're gonna ask our third polling question. So off the top of your head, just your kind of immediate reaction, as you think about your life categories, where your time goes and where your priorities are they in family relationship? Are they in work? Are they in your spiritual life, your spiritual beliefs, rest, laughter, play, or the energy and time you put into your physical health? So we'll take a look at what this might look at for you personally. Okay.
So it looks like we have, for most important life category, 82% of participants voted for A, family relationships, 29% voted for work, 20% voted for C, spiritual beliefs, and 30% voted for D, rest, laughter, play, and 20% voted for E, physical health.
Okay, so people are setting their priorities around family relationships, and that's a good thing. Happy to hear that that category and even other categories as well didn't get sacrificed for the work category. That's great. So we're gonna look a little bit deeper at this circle of life, and this is actually a handout attached in the handout panel of this presentation. So this exercise asks you to take this pie chart and divide it into a number of life categories, those ones that we asked in the polling question, and also breaks it down into more including community activities, et cetera. And you know, you can feel free based on your own lifestyle to add categories, but charting out how much time is in each little section of this pie, you might do this on your own time to get a sense of kind of where your time investment lies. It can be a useful exercise. Okay, as we move on. So important, you know, as we talk a lot about and have in stress training, work-life balance, and how do we keep our center? And we've learned years ago that being mindful of our breathing in terms of those deep belly breaths, and when we're at a moment of stress, that to remind ourselves to breathe and to do it deeply can help us feel better almost instantly is a good thing to remember. Giving yourself kind of 15 minutes of your own time in the morning can set you off on a more balanced on a more balanced day, whether that's taking a cup of coffee, you know, back to bed, or just daydreaming, or what that is, but that you've got that time of your own as you begin your day. Personalizing your workspace, putting things that are important to you in your workspace, whether those are photos or objects that you associate with things, can be really helpful. Setting boundaries with difficult people. You know, we can have our day fraught with dealing with people that we find difficult for us personally, based on our personality and theirs. So getting comfortable with setting boundaries with people can relieve stress and give you more time. Being conscious of what you eat, you know, when we're nervous and stressed, then that can be the time when we turn to refined sugars and carbs and fats. And then afterwards, we wonder why we don't feel so well. So being conscious of that and trying to eat fruits and vegetables. And one thing that we don't have on this that I wanted to just verbally add, is drinking lots of water throughout the day. It cleanses us. It helps. Being hydrated makes all the difference. Staying in the present time, mindfulness, when that your mind starts to go to what you're going to do after work or the weekend or all the stressors ahead, kind of course correct that and bring that back. If you can, you know, taking off your shoes, planting your feet, keeping your center is what we're looking at now. And some more tips on keeping your center. Whoops, that's my mistake. Okay, our next, whoops, that was my fault, Brenda. So our next polling question. Our perception of a stressful event is more important than the stressful event itself. True or false?
Okay. It looks like we have 98% voting for true. That's 2% voted for false.
Yeah. Yeah, it is absolutely true. You know, our brain can't tell the difference between what we think is a real stressor or what our perception of it is. So this is just, you know, we'll be talking in a slide or two about how important our perceptions are, and that's what we have control over. So you're right on in terms of knowing that that's the answer. But before we do that, I think our next slide will have a little few more tips on keeping our center. So using some what we call, you know, decompression or re-entry rituals to separate our roles. So kind of what we listen to on the way home, whether we're on public transportation or the car, are those, you know, decompression tapes or stress relieving tapes, and hopefully not the news that can make you more stressed by the time you get home. Do you go to the gym on the way home, or go by a park or something that can help kind of with that ratcheting down from one role to the other? I believe strongly that when you hit the house, or if you work at home, that you change clothes from your kind of work clothes to your home clothes in a more relaxed environment can help us. And you know, we can get so used to using our rule of thumb for work that we can over plan our home time, and where we have so many activities to attend to personally and with our kids. So trying to leave some space in our home time can be really valuable. And this is interesting, trying to challenge yourself to spend a weekend without getting in your car, doing activities around the house, walking, biking, and kind of learning to get in touch with your own special creativity. Maybe it's something you haven't discovered yet, and open up your thinking by what that might be for you. So keeping your center in those ways. So now kind of back to looking at that perception piece with the next slide that talks about the stress cycle. So you may have also heard this as kind of, you know, an ABC formula, but an event we can think of as the A, and that's becomes then the actual fact, and then it's our perception of it, and even then our physical response to that. Are we feeling stressed? Are we talking to ourselves in a stressful way that then affects our feelings? So watching that thinking that this is terrible. Another way of looking at it is, why is this upsetting? Why me? What information do I need? Or I'll show them, as opposed to I can control only what I do. Another piece right here is looking, being on the watch for the what I call the three P's, that a stressful event is pervasive, that it affects all of our life, that it's permanent, that it's never going to get better, and that it's personal, that it's targeted at me. So knowing when we're doing that and when to change that channel not to. So next. So breaking the stress cycle, you know, controlling our perception by me being more positive. You know, primitively when we were in the jungle, we saw a saber-toothed tiger, we might fight or flight, which was a very adaptive thing to do. But when our environment includes saber-toothed tigers, that can be put us on edge all the time. So knowing the difference, creating space around events, and looking at that self-talk that occurs when stressful events happen. So some examples of that in our next slide. So you may have heard of David Burns. David Burns is a psychiatrist that even in the 80s realized that the way we thought about things and then our behavior affected our feelings about things, that we could actually control the outcome by looking at the way we thought about things, what our behavior looked like, and then what our feelings were. So looking, keeping it, look out for all or nothing thinking, having a negative reaction to that, and maybe some positive reactions instead. Overgeneralizing, a tendency to use a single event as an ever-ending pattern of defeat, dwelling on the mental filtering, dwelling on the negative, ignoring the positive, or jumping to conclusions. So taking a look at the negatives and then looking at the positives can be helpful in this way. And then we've got a few more on the next slide in terms of magnifying issues, exaggerating or minimizing, and what some positive responses might look like. Using what we call emotional reasoning, taking your emotions as evidence of truth instead of what the truth is, you know, feeling like an idiot so you are an idiot, rather than acknowledging that you can make a mistake. Labeling things that can make us feel more negative. Personalizing and blaming, taking responsibility for a negative event. You know, watching others' behaviors and thinking, oh my goodness, it must be my fault, rather than I wonder if that person is just having a bad day. Or shooting ourselves to death, you know, where we're browbeating ourselves through guilt, are things to be mindful for when we look at self-talk. And you know, we program ourselves all day long by what we're thinking. So if we do it more positively, the outcome is going to be more positive. So in the next slide, we know that we can't change an event, but we can change our perception. So keeping ourselves on track in terms of our thoughts and our beliefs, looking at how it could be realistic, challenging our negative thoughts. How would I feel if I were more rested? How might somebody else think about it? Replacing those thoughts with rational, positive thoughts. All right, next. So sometimes our work exposes us to really difficult situations and events and personal issues of others where our environment gives us what we call compassion fatigue, that we're feeling for our environment. And this can be absolutely depleting and exhausting. So if this is an issue for you, some remedies are some quiet time, time alone, recharging our batteries with what nurtures you, whether that's exercise or yoga or meditating, whatever it is. I like this one, holding one focused, connected, and meaningful conversation each day with a family member, loved one, or a coworker. But, having something like that occurs at least one day. And as we've talked before, finding balance and activities outside of work. Some words of advice, not blaming others, knowing that you have control over what you have control over, limiting that kind of complaining, that reflex that can happen sometimes. Not trying for a quick fix, but slowing things down, and not making big decisions until you feel better. You may have heard of the acronym HALT, not making decisions when we're hungry, angry, lonely, or tired. So knowing that we need things to recharge us as we before we're able to really soundly make a big decision. So as we're kind of winding down, we'll move to the next slide. So we love studies, and Duke University did a study on how to increase our feelings of well-being. Number one, cultivating a positive and optimistic outlook. They really found that, focusing nursing resentments or grudges made people feel unhappy, and so living in the present was much more positive way to go. Focusing on what's in our control, always, number one. Being realistic about expectations that we have of ourselves, and having compassion for ourselves in this way, and accepting our humanness and our imperfections, and that in fact we're going to make mistakes, and so are others. So knowing that, having meaning in your life, that there's something bigger than us, and to give us meaning, whether that's raising our children or a faith or a movement or a cause. Such good research on how support systems heal us and support us. So knowing that's important. And refusing to be a victim, understanding the difference between accepting an unwelcome event or allowing it to define who we are. So, evicting the victim, I call it. So I think we're headed towards our last polling question. So in the coming days, what will you practice? Assessing your signs of distress or overload, slowing down your hurry sickness, regaining your center, focusing on self-talk, cultivating peace of mind. Okay,
thank you, Karen.
You're
looks
welcome.
Like we have 36% voted for A, assessing your signs of distress or overload. 51% voted for B, slowing hurry sickness. 38% voted for C, regaining your center. And 49% voted for D, focusing on positive self-talk. And 36% voted for E, cultivating peace of mind.
Okay, that's great. And there's certainly overlap in terms of the tools that we use, but it sounds like it's kind of heightened. It does for me when I present this, heightens for me the kinds of things that we need to keep in mind as we move forward. It's so easy to get out of balance. So next, I think we have one more little tool that you can use on your own, and it's kind of another way of assessing your wheel of life, where you give yourself a number on any category next to that big dot, which would indicate less energy put into the category. And then as you cultivate things, maybe that moves closer to the category itself with a number up to 5. So something that, you know, just kind of keeps us on target as we move forward. Then the next slide's got some book suggestions, some tools. And I wanted to add one more is the Feeling Good book by David Burns. It's just an overall book on how we kind of assess depression and then deal with it, and lots of good tools to use if that's an issue for us.
And Karen,
yes.
Who was the author of that book? I'm sorry.
It's David Burns.
Okay. David Burns.
Burns. Uh-huh. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. So it looks like we've got about 5 minutes left. I want to do a little infomercial on the EAP, which, you know, the holidays can be a stressful time for us. We've got so many things that we're having to deal with, and holidays are not always easy for people. So know that that resource is available for counseling, work-life balancing, legal, financial issues. You just, you know, call the number, and there's a number of things. And we reviewed distress and stress and gave some tips. Any questions before we close? I certainly appreciate, I know an hour is a lot to invest, but I'm glad you did. And I think that there are things that we can gain always from rehearing tools and tips. Any questions before we end?
Yeah, we have a few questions.
Okay.
So how long does it take to establish a good habit?
2 to 3 weeks. 2 to 3 weeks. It's interesting how they did that, I don't know. But there's about the way the brain works, you know, as we start. I think about it personally as like we get in a habit, and I think about it as a rut, like a running track in my brain. The more we're in that running track, the deeper the rut gets. So how we change a habit is to get into a run in a different place. So the dirt then kind of comes back in that rut, and then you're establishing, you're kind of seeding the new territory with new behaviors. But 2 to 3 weeks, which, and people oftentimes, you'll go try something, they'll give up. And so patience with yourself, and just know that every day we build on addressing thought patterns that might not be helpful and starting new habits, the closer we're getting to be that becoming a positive habit for us? Good question.
Okay, thank you, Karen. I do have another question here. Do you have any recommended books or podcasts for time management?
You know, I think that we're all, we kind of have some different personal ways of doing that. And what I'd do is I'd Google it. I'd Google time management and look at what appeals to me. You know, kind of the benchmark one was that, can't think of his name. It was called Seven Habits of Effective People. And that was his first work. And then he had calendars and all kinds of things that he did. And there were some effective tools in there. But I would, I'd look at some of the things that we offered here in terms of time management, but I would Google to see what most fits for you. I think plans are good. You know, I think that keeping a calendar is good. And I think always building in time for the unexpected, because we don't want to get thrown psychologically or, you know, time-wise when it doesn't fit the time schedule we've allowed.
Okay, thank you, Karen.
Sure.
All right, so next question. What are some tips to redirect thinking? For example, to help me stop thinking about work in the shower before I leave for work.
Okay, so I can tell you what has worked for me and what I recommend when I'm working with clients is I use a red stop sign. When I start thinking about what keeps me on target, or which is the opposite of mindfulness, I will have this visual picture of a stop sign and I'll say, Karen, stop. And then I'll replace that picture with what's more effective. Now, I'm a very visual person. So that's what helps me. I think other people will go kind of immediately to the place that they feel the most at peace, or, you know, put a picture of a loved one in their head or whatever. But I think that even kind of setting down with pencil and paper and saying, what will I do when this happens? What will be the first thing I do? What will be the second thing I do? Puts tools in those toolbox so that when it happens, and it does, it's going to happen. The other thing is changing positions. Like when you're in the shower, even like turning your body around and using that as a signal. But if you get a thought stuck in your head, if you get up, move around, change what I call change channels, it can be very effective.
Okay, thank you, Karen. We do have time for one last question here.
Okay.
What is your first reaction to let you know that you're recognizing when you're stressed?
So I think that I think we get a visceral reaction. In other words, I think our body tells us. I think that if you get in touch with when an event happens that can be stressful, it may be that muscles can tense up, that you can feel it in, if you're sitting under your desk or you're sitting, that you might feel the muscles in your legs tense up. You might feel your shoulders tense up, very common for people. I think that your breathing can become more shallow. That can be a warning signal. I think that if you start feeling, you know, agitated or impatient, I think it's different for all of us. But I think that we have to kind of listen to what our body and our mind is trying to tell us. And so that when those signals come, then you can choose to intervene on them or not. Anything else?
I think that's all we have for today.
All
yeah.
Right. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, thanks again, everyone, so much for attending, taking your time. Happy holidays and Happy New Year. Until next time.